Alrighty. We will get this going now. Welcome to the Legislative Branch Capacity Working Group. I see a number of new faces out there, so let me just introduce myself. I'm Kevin Kosar. I co-direct this group. I work at the R Street Institute. And here is Lee Drutman of New America, who also co-directs this group. We've been doing this since April 2016. We meet basically every month, August and December excepted. And the point of this group is to kick around ideas and propositions about congressional capacity and how to strengthen it. Now, let me do a few housekeeping items before we get to today's discussion on regulation. First, I want to thank Senator Moran's office, who once again was able to procure this room for us. It's a difficult thing to work to get a room in the CVC, and so every month we've been going hat in hand quickly to Senator Moran's office and asking for the assistance, and we're very grateful for it, because the meetings just wouldn't happen without it. Second, if anyone would like a Make Congress Great Again hat, they are available out there on the table. They're free for the taking. We're going to order some more in because I think we've burned through about 400 of them in the last month. And if you know anybody who might want one, you know, just pop me an email and we're happy to have them shipped out. Third thing, if you've not signed up for our newsletter, which comes two, three times a week and is a quick read, please consider doing so. To get to the newsletter is really simple. It takes about 10 seconds to get it. You go to our site, ledgebranch.com. You click the newsletter button. You type your name. You type your email address. Voila. We also post on the site articles and studies and things that we think that are useful and interesting about all the various aspects of congressional capacity, which, as we construe it, covers pretty much everything that you could imagine, whether it's congressional staffing, levels, compensation, the legislative support agencies, congressional procedure, committees, jurisdictions, et cetera, et cetera. We define capacity very widely, and so you'll find a lot of stuff on the site on a range of subjects. Fourth, if any of you would like to write for ledgebranch.com, please let me know. And yes, I understand that some, if not many of you, are in sensitive positions where you would not want your name attached to something. And yes, we can run things under a pseudonym or anonymously as needed. But one of the basic ideas of this whole working group is that we want to pool disparate expertise. There's a ton of smarts on the Hill, there's a ton of smarts in the town, and we want ledgebranch.com to be kind of a place where we pile it all off. Again, this is a nonpartisan venture. We take all comers. We just want people who have ideas, experience that they can share, that can prove valuable. And I just want to call out one example of this, a recent example of this, where we had a blog post that I thought was really important. So you'll remember a few weeks back, there was quite the storm on Capitol Hill when word came out that there were Hill staff, committee staff, who worked on a Trump executive order involving extreme vetting or whatever it may be called. And there was a lot of, heat around the topic. And what we did was we reached out to one of our regular attendees, Michael Stern, who is a former senior House counsel, and just asked him to kind of say, well, what sort of rules are in play here? And so he wrote this nice essay that we put on the site, and within 48 hours it had 500 reads. And primarily these reads are coming from the Hill and the surrounding think tanks. And so I think, this was a chance where we were able to take expertise that's part of the group and bring it to bear on an issue that was getting a lot of heat and kind of elevate the conversation to a little more sophisticated level. So thank you for that. But if any of you can help on that count, if an issue comes up and you think you want to chime in some way, please reach out to me. So let's get to our topic of the day. We'll follow the usual format, brief presentations, then we'll open the discussion to the floor. I'll note that we have at least two reporters in the room, but that doesn't mean you need to be afraid to say your name before you comment, because we've got an agreement that only those of us on the dais will have comments attributed to any of us. So you're safe. And our topic of the day is, what role should Congress have in regulation? And to get us started, my colleague at the R Street Institute, Jared Dieterle, is going to just talk a little bit about how rulemaking gets done.
Thank you. I'm going to pop up a chart here to help us. I know this might be a little bit difficult to see in the back of the room, but try to zoom in as much as possible. This is from Maeve Carey at the Congressional Research Service, one of her reports. I'm just generally going to quickly lay out a 10,000-foot overview of the rulemaking process under the Administrative Procedure Act. This is probably familiar territory to a lot of people in this room, but for those that are unfamiliar, it'll probably tee us up to get into our in-depth discussion today. First of all, as you can see at the top of the chart there, to get a regulation going, Congress usually has to pass a statute, oftentimes called an authorizing statute, which they delegate power to an executive agency to make regulations in a certain area or on a certain topic. And then once the agency goes about enacting those regulations, they usually have to adhere to the procedures, as I mentioned, in the Administrative Procedure Act, called the APA by its acronym. And traditionally, it's a process called notice and comment, in which the agency will publish a notice of proposed rulemaking in the Federal Register. And then they will have a period of public comment in which industry participants or other public actors can comment on the regulation, offer critiques or suggested modifications. And then the agency will consider public input, and then will ultimately reissue a final ruling. You can see the public comment section here, and then finally the publication of the final rule. There's a lot of steps in here, as you'll know, that I'm not going into in depth. Things like centralized review for significant regulations, ones that have an effect of $100 million or more on the economy. They have a centralized review component for those in the executive office of the president. And that's usually the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs, or OIRA, as it's known. But anyways, that's the general process laid out there, the notice and comment process. Once the final rule is published in the Federal Register, the rule takes effect. Now, there's multiple exceptions, of course, to everything that I just said. For less formal agency actions, things like guidance documents, policy statements, oftentimes agencies don't have to go through the notice and comment process. And there's also interim final rulemaking and direct final rulemaking and stuff that probably is more detailed than we need to get into at least yet today. But the key kind of takeaway you can see from this is that at the very top, Congress has a role, of course, when they pass the statute, an authorizing statute, but oftentimes that's just them delegating power to the agency. And it really isn't until the very end at the bottom, in the bottom right hand, the Congressional Review, after the rule's taken effect under the Congressional Review Act, the CRA, that Congress can pass a joint resolution of disapproval and send that to the president to potentially overturn an agency action. And I think we're going to get into this more today, but until very recently, the Congressional Review Act has been relatively underutilized process. So Congress is kind of a bit player in the passing of regulations, other than things like a general appropriations powers, of course, and oversight powers. They're kind of relegated to the beginning and the end of the process. So that's a brief overview that I think sets us up to drill down a little bit more on what role Congress can have in regulations.
Thank you, Jared. I'll keep my comments brief and kind of turn back the clock a little bit. I first want to call your attention to an old but really good article by a guy I used to work with at Congressional Research Service, Fred Kaiser. He brought it to my attention the other week, and you know, the title, Congressional Control of Executive Actions in the Aftermath of the Chadha Decision. That's a mouthful, but it's a good piece. As many of you probably know, Congress used to do something that was called legislative vetoes, and it was a unicameral way for Congress to check an executive branch agency's action. But then in the Supreme Court Chadha Decision, that particular process was called unconstitutional. No doubt attorneys in this room could explain that further if anybody wants to find out about it during Q&A. So that took a tool away from Congress. But what Kaiser's article, and I have, it's an academic article behind a paywall, but I have PDF copies if anyone wants, you know, let me know. What his article shows is that despite losing this tool, Congress does have a variety of ways where it can play a role in the rulemaking process, one that doesn't readily square with the made carry chart on the rulemaking process that was previously displayed. He notes that, for example, Congress can conduct oversight hearings kind of with the express purpose of trying to mobilize opposition to particular rules and to stoke public comment. He notes that Congress can also set appropriations and authorization limitations or prohibitions to stop agencies from promulgating, issuing, or enforcing a rule. He notes Congress can allocate more time for public comment to just try to get more folks in the record criticizing the rule, and so forth. And it was an interesting article to see because it shows us the breadth of the toolbox that Congress has, but the question that I come away with is, how often is that toolbox being used? I think one thing that we see on Capitol Hill is that you have generational turnovers and some of the institutional knowledge goes away. And people forget that certain things can be done. Let's take one example, Congressional Review Act. That was passed in 1996, signed by President Bill Clinton, bipartisan effort. It was used once in 2001, and then it became largely forgotten. I mean, members of Congress, if you go and you look at congress.gov, they hardly were introducing even the resolutions, even just as kind of a political grandstanding maneuver, like I'm gonna stand up against this resolution regulation. They weren't even using it. It's like they forgot it existed, even though it was a no-cost proposition to just introduce one of these bills. And now all of a sudden it's back with vengeance. People suddenly realize, hey, this thing exists, and as it happens, the political cards have been shuffled in such a way that it can actually be used to strike down rules, and it is being used. So let me move on to the second point, which is that by my take, and I hope there are others in this room during Q&A who will upbraid me for this and explain to me why it's wrong, it seems to me that for the most part, most members of Congress do not play an active role in regulation. Yes, there are committees. Yes, there are particular individuals who do reg work regularly. But your average member, so far as I can discern, it's not something that's a major part of their workload or the work that their staff does, except perhaps on an ad hoc basis. And I think there are various reasons for that, one of which is habit. I mean, if you don't kind of get trained up as a new member of Congress by somebody else saying you need to pay attention to regulations, you need to do the sort of spade work, you're not going to do it because it's not exactly a particularly sexy thing to do by most members' lives. It's not something they think about. They think about the spending, they think about the bills before Congress and that sort of stuff. Second, there's very little political incentive to pay attention. And unfortunately, when members do pay attention, frequently it's not to engage regulation in a serious way, but it's rather to beat up on the bureaucrats. And on the one hand, you vote for a law that's vaguely written, that kicks discretion over to the bureaucracy, then you don't pay attention to it, and then a rule is promulgated per the law, and you respond by getting up and denouncing the out-of-control bureaucrats who are running amok. And it makes for great campaign speeches, but what else? Frequently, not a whole lot. should mention David Schonbrod, who wrote a book years ago called Power Without Responsibility, and who recently had a piece in the Hill, kind of harping on this same theme, that there's a real incentive to kind of kick things to the executive branch and kind of accept the credit for saying, I voted for cleaner air, but then to grandstand and beat up the bureaucrats for not doing things, you know, that your constituents like. And lastly, this kind of tees up our next speaker, I think members of Congress often don't take on regulation as a regular activity, because there's just not the capacity. Regulations are astonishingly complex. They're often the product of years of work by extremely smart people. They're meticulous, they can run a couple hundred pages. And they're produced at a rate of a few thousand per year. Some of them are really tiny, some of them are really massive, but they just keep coming. And I don't think there are many congressional staffs out there that have the manpower to actually go through this stuff every week and try to figure out if there are issues involved. And so I think that explains it largely, but there could be other factors. If you don't have the capacity, you can't fully do the job. So enough of me. Let us move on to the man of the hour, Philip Walt of Brookings Institution, who has some thoughts on Congress and on its capacity to engage in regulation and what might be done to improve its capacity.
Okay. Thanks, Kevin, and thank you all for being here. It's been a real pleasure for me to be involved in this group. I've learned a lot listening to folks here on the Hill, and I'm very much hoping for feedback, constructive or angry, to any of this, if you can tell me better. So, first of all, you know, we're treating regulation as sort of a special topic here today, but is it really that special? To my mind, it's not that different from a lot of other policymaking, which some of the same maladies attached to, but regulation itself is vast and extremely consequential. It's a big part of what the federal government does, given that the congressional passivity that Kevin just described is especially distressing to my mind. There's nothing forcing Congress to systematically revisit this vast body of regulation that governs the American economy. There's nothing like the budget process that sort of makes us take up trade-offs on a regular basis. I think it's pretty clear that there's been a trend toward the executive branch finding within its regulatory toolbox that Congress has bequeathed to it over the years. It now has the ability to sort of undertake ambitious policy initiatives never contemplated by Congress, while circumventing Congress, cutting them out of the process. Basically, Congress doesn't win anymore when it comes to regulation. And, you know, that's for sure in large part the situation we're in is a result of congressional choices over the years. It's not a matter of the executive branch having snatched something away from an unwilling Congress. Congress has purposefully built up the administrative state to respond to social problems that it felt warranted federal intervention, and it quite purposely gave lots of discretion to agencies to figure out the best regulatory approaches. Congress does not see itself as capable of doing the kind of detailed work that's necessary to sustain the regulatory state, and I don't think that's going to change. But that does not mean that Congress, with the same sort of purposefulness, wanted to find itself in this sort of situation of planned obsolescence, which we find itself in now. I really, really recommend the book called Building a Legislative-Centered Public Administration by David Rosenblum, a public administration scholar. Gives a really clear picture of how, over the years, Congress sought to keep its keep its role in public administration and in regulatory government quite central, even as it realized that a lot of the legwork was going to be done by the executive because of all the delegation it had. In many ways, it undertook reforms that nevertheless tried to keep Congress as a part of the ongoing government work in a way that, in America, in a way that a lot of European countries, for example, there's no pretension that the parliament will be sort of involved. That's all for the government. Parliament is out of that game. But Congress has not just embraced that with open arms. It has done quite a lot to structure itself. But my sense is that in the last couple decades, especially, that Congress has kind of fallen down in that role. And so part of, you know, this is a matter of, is Congress willing and is Congress able to take a more active role in regulatory policy? I think there is a willingness question. Maybe they're not always so willing, but there's also an ability question, which is very familiar to folks who have been attending these meetings now over the last year. You know, there were more resources to support Congress thinking about regulatory issues. In past decades, the Office of Technology Assessment was certainly a lot of the issues that it touched on were regulatory issues. There's just the overall staffing stagnation in Congress. And, you know, and meanwhile, this is as the executive branch has gotten much, much larger and harder to monitor over the years. So I think there's a willingness problem, but there is also a capacity and ability problem that we would be wise to address. So Kevin and I co-authored an article proposing a congressional regulation office, which is an idea that has kicked around a little bit over the years, but we hope can gain some more traction now. So what would a congressional regulation office actually do? We for the record, kind of contemplate it being about the shape and size of the Congressional Budget Office, which has an annual budget something like $45 million, a couple of hundred employees. So that's a pittance in the scheme of the federal budget, but it has a really outsized impact on the budget's coherence and Congress's ability to be an assertive, useful player in the budget, at least in theory. We know that the budget process is not so great right now, also for various reasons. But we think that having a parallel kind of congressional regulation office could make a huge difference in allowing Congress to assume a constructive role. So how would it do that? Well, first of all, it would give Congress a parallel capacity to what's in OIRA today. So the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs, nested within OMB, it is the one that sort of, on behalf of the executive branch, carries out some cost-benefit analyses to ensure that the agencies are playing it straight. But of course, the agencies are working sort of under the president in the org chart, and OIRA works for the president. So there is a sense of some amount of conflictedness there. So having an agency within Congress that's able to do these analyses would offer a true outside perspective, which I think would have a very useful sort of disciplining effect and a useful legitimating function also, in that we can really trust these analyses. And ideally that would be reported to committees of jurisdiction in some way that gave them a chance to respond before rules became effective. I'm frankly more excited about the second thing on this list as a potential for the CRO or CRO. What do we think? How would we pronounce this? I'm not decided yet. So that is to say that we need some mechanism whereby capacity in Congress is applied to the question of, well, just what do we have in this vast body of regulation? How well is it working? Where has it gone haywire? Where is it costing us a lot without returning the benefits that were once envisioned? So this is a thing that has a lot of enthusiasm, including had some in the Obama administration, the idea that we should be doing regulatory lookbacks. But the truth is, it's gotten a lot of lip service, and there's been some window dressing, but we haven't really done anything to force the issue. And it's something that will take a lot of resources, and it should be done not just at the level of, is this individual rule sensible, but is our policy around this area sensible? And that would cut across not just several rules, but also several agencies, which, you know, we have all this regulatory overlap in financial regulation. You'll have issues where you have the Securities and Exchange Commission and the Commodities Futures Trading Commission and the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency and all of these different regulators involved. And we don't really have systematic mechanisms to evaluate whether the policies that all of these agencies jointly produce are making sense, are working, could be done in a less costly way. So I'm very enthusiastic about this idea that the Congressional Regulation Office could be a home for doing such studies. If the CRO had a reputation for independence, those could be seen as trustworthy. They could be given some procedural way to spark congressional action, some kind of fast track process. But just having sustained effort to that question, I think, would make a huge difference. And finally, kind of an ancillary function, which is in some ways reminiscent of the Office of Technology Assessment, would be to facilitate Congress having productive engagement with experts. So, again, we don't imagine that Congress is suddenly going to have all of the capacity of the executive branch over here on the Hill somehow. That's not going to happen. It's just the executive branch is two orders of magnitude bigger. And so you're not going to bridge that gap. But even just helping Congress to sort of know which outside critics are worth crediting and bringing in, and trying to have some kind of efforts to survey scientific literature in ways such that they could understand what to make of them. So helping to sort signal from noise, I think that could be a very productive function, help Congress perform its oversight duties much more effectively, constructively. So, to deal with the willingness problem alongside the ability, you probably do need to do something in terms of changing the rules to have Congress force itself to get into this work. And so a lot of the regulatory reform ideas that are circulating over the past few years and in the current Congress get at this idea in one way or another. And so does the president's one in, two out initiative, which a lot of people see that as very gimmicky and crude. I can understand why. It's not clear what a rule is, and so the units of analysis there are pretty up for grabs until the OMB director defines them. But I really do sympathize with the impulse, which is that we just need something to force agencies to think of revisiting old regulation as equally important as the more exciting work of passing new regulations. We don't have anything that does that right now. So there's this thing called the Scrub Act, which I forget what that acronym is for anymore, but that would create a sort of BRAC-like commission to go through and find old rules that would then be sort of fast track for destruction unless Congress intervened to save them. I think a lot of things. And so in setting up a Congressional Regulation Office that would do these searching retrospective reviews, it would be most effective for sure if that was attached to rules that then forced Congress to take up those recommendations and rework things. So just to sort of zoom out a little bit, because I ultimately, I think a Congressional Regulation Office really would be extremely constructive, but there's a little bit of a broader point that I hope we get across here, which is just that Congress needs to find some way to get more involved. And So I have three sort of orientations toward regulation, and I came up with some alliterations. So opportunistic ombudsman, ideological idolaters, and legitimating legislators. So obviously this is a little bit stacked, which one I prefer there. So the ombudsman role is really an important one, and I don't mean to slight it too much. It's sort of the old idea of fire alarm, right? Constituents come often via help from their lobbyists to Congress and say, this rule is doing me harm, please fix it. And to some extent, Congress is responsive to those. If it reacts, it can make somebody happy, it can win a friend for life. And so I think Congress does this role to some degree. I think the way that the RAINS Act regulations from the executive in need of scrutiny is structured now, I think it would mostly amplify the fire alarm kind of dynamic. Congress would get a whole lot of rules that it would have to say yay or nay to, and mostly it would say yay, unless it got someone forcefully advancing the case that in this case it should say nay, because the agency has run roughshod over their interests. If RAINS was amended somehow such that it took in a lesser number of rules and gave Congress more capacity to work through the rules that it was supposed to vote yay or nay on, then I could see RAINS becoming something more constructive than that. You know, ideological idolaters, you know, there's position taking is a sort of bread and butter of electioneering. It's always going to be a staple, and on lots of regulatory issues, the dynamic that Kevin described earlier is always going to be with us. You know, people saying pass a law, tell the agency to go do X, they do X in a way that makes somebody unhappy. How dare they do X? You know, this is a violation of our fundamental constitutional liberties, and the worst bureaucratic nightmare to boot, right? That's always going to go on to some degree, and I don't imagine anything I say would affect that. But what I really want to leave you with is this idea of this legitimating function that I think legislators need to play. So it's not just a matter of, you know, we might think it's part of, goes along with that old metaphor between fire alarm and police patrol. I don't think so. A police patrol sort of knows what it's trying to prevent, and sort of it walks the beat knowing what it's trying to do. The legitimating work that legislators need to do with regulation is much harder than that. It needs to revisit legislation, revisit regulatory policies where we don't exactly know what's gone wrong, and dig into them and say, hey, we haven't revisited this in 30 years. Let's get into it and amend the statute as is necessary, sort of refresh the compromise for today's politics and today's facts on the ground. And I can understand why Congress doesn't want to do that. That's instead of just sort of easy rhetoric, that requires difficult compromises and serious capacity to do the work. But I think that is what really needs to be done to ensure that we have an administrative state that we believe reflects the will of the people in some meaningful way, and that we believe is getting meaningfully scrutinized by the first branch. So I'll leave it at that. I would be delighted for any comments that people want to send my way, and I'm sure Kevin would also.
All right, so now we move into the